So welcome to this session on gunas. What I felt in all these years of teaching and all, that gunas are like foundations of life, human life, and we are very much unaware of the roles which gunas play in our life. Okay, so in the first couple of classes, 2021 and 22 batch, I didn't realize it. That people are so ignorant about it. So there was no specific session on gunas. From 2023 batch, I started including one session on gunas, and I realized that it helped people a lot. Okay. So I'm just having like one session today for everyone, because everyone should know about the some basic foundational things of human life. Okay. When it comes to astrology, the main like question which comes into the mind of people who question or who have doubts over astrology, the main question they ask is that if two children take birth on the same date, same time, and same place, will their life will be identical? Okay, this is the main question people ask. Suppose best example twins. Okay, hardly like 2 3 minutes difference in their birth time. They take birth in the same family, same environment, and all. Are they going to live as identical life? Will they behave and react in the identical manner in under identical circumstances? It doesn't happen so. Okay, like. Twins also live a different life. One twin becomes a doctor, another becomes a engineer or something like that. So where the difference happens, okay, what makes the difference in choices of people and all, that is what we are going to understand today with this session. So twins is also example, and I was also told, I'm also told that when I was born, in the same night, 16 other children took birth in the same hospital. Okay, in the same hospital, forget about the city, same hospital, 16 other children took birth. Many of them took birth around the same time range. Like my time of birth and their time of birth was like very very close by. Are they all astrologers today? Are they all teaching astrology today? Okay. If not, then why? Okay. What makes this difference? What makes the difference in the choice? So that is what our focus will be in today's session. Okay, anyone new? Yeah, I don't think you're right. Emily, your cam is on, so I'm picking on you. And everyone can do this at their place. Just observe yourself, your mind for 1 minute. For 1 minute, just observe your mind, what is happening there. Everyone can do it and share later on. 1 minute. Right. Any opinion? Like what was there when you were observing?
I am serving.
Sorry?
Oh, I have to talk?
Yeah.
Oh,
Like
okay.
so
So my
when you were
mind.
observing, yeah, when you were observing, what was in the mind?
Well, it was kind of not empty, but like if I was on the clouds, you know?
Okay. Anyone else want to share? Yeah, Raag. Your mic is off.
Yeah. So, sir, I just felt some energy moving, like no thoughts, like no words or something. I was not thinking anything. I just felt like energy moving.
Great. Good job. Yeah. Anyone else wants to share? Radha Madam, Fateji, Tirisha, Ian sir.
I missed Lord. The question.
Yeah, go ahead, Radhaji.
Yeah, Sirisha, tell me.
Yeah, a lot of thoughts going around this.
Right. Okay.
Not stable at all. Yeah.
Right. Okay, so understand if we are truly in observant mode, only the observer remains. There cannot be anything else in the mind. Okay? If I just move away from this chair, what do you see? Anyone?
Nothing. Chair, just chair.
No. You see chair and you see my absence. Okay. Understand this. Among all the elements, if you remove everything from the existence, space remains. Okay. If I remove everything from this room, what will be left? Space. Okay, space is the basic element which is giving space to every other element. We have five elements as we know, like ether, fire, air, water and earth. Space or ether is one which is giving space to everything else.
Main andar chali ja rahi hu.
Space is one element which is giving a space to every other element to function. Okay, you cannot remove space. Same space is known as pure consciousness. Same space is known as energy. Same space we know as like soul or whatever we want to call. Okay, same space. When a child takes birth, he takes birth as pure consciousness, pure space. Okay, a child takes birth, he takes birth as a pure consciousness. In between this session, if you have any question, please note it down. I will respond to all questions. Initial 1.5 hours will be a monologue. I will be speaking. Then I will take all the questions. Okay. So, to start with, child takes birth as pure consciousness. I have to draw something, so I drew this line. Otherwise, there is nothing like we cannot represent a space of consciousness in a picture. I have to draw something to indicate you this is a space. Okay, this is consciousness. So understand, when a child takes birth, he takes birth as pure consciousness. That's why a child is so happy. Okay, there are no thoughts in his mind. Even if thoughts are coming and going, they are coming and going within seconds. There is no focus on any thought. Okay, that's why he is so happy. He hasn't become prime minister or president, but he is very happy. Okay. We have achieved many things in our life, but we are not happy. Okay? Then when child takes birth, after conditioning starts, which develops the mind. Okay? Conditioning means the whichever family he has taken birth, that family will tell a lot of things. Okay, you are this person, you are that person, you are this caste, that religion, this country, and if your country is in danger, you should be ready to die for the country and all. That is all the conditioning will start. So what will happen? This mind will overlap the consciousness. Consciousness will go into the background and this conditioning will come over the consciousness. This mind will take over the consciousness. Okay. Now this conditioning can be of three parts, three types. Okay. We can have many discussions in our life, but if there is a meaningful discussion, this is the meaningful discussion we are having. Conditioning can be either of destroying something or of creating something or of sustaining something. Either tamas, rajas or sat. Okay. These are three gunas. Understand, just like when light passes through the prism, it splits into seven different colors with gear. Okay. When light passes through the prism, it splits into seven different colors. Likewise, when energy passes through the mind, it gets split into three gunas, three type of activities. When spiritual gurus are saying that this whole world is interplay of gunas or made of gunas, that means only these three activities are happening in this world. When Krishna is saying in Bhagavad Gita that the whole world is interplay of gunas or gun guno mein bharat rahe hain, that is it. Only gunas are functioning. The consciousness is in the background. It is observing. Okay, it is not functioning. It is just observing. So these are the three gunas. What are they? Tamas, rajas, and sattva. Or better way will be rajas, sattva and tamas. Rajas is creation energy, creative energy. We create something new. Okay? Sattva is sustaining energy. We sustain that thing. And then tamas, the destructive energy, we destroyed that thing. Okay? All three activities, only these three activities are happening in this world. Okay? Means either you can create something or you can sustain something or you can destroy something. Nothing else can happen in this world. Few examples. We started this call. I initiated this call. That is rajas. We are sustaining this call right now. That is sattva. At some point of time, we have to end this call. That is tamas. Morning happens, morning comes, that is rajas, start creation of new day. We go through the day, that is sattva, sustenance of the day. Night comes and we go to sleep, that is tamas. A child takes birth, that is rajas, creation. Child goes through the whole life of 70, 80 years, that is sustenance, sattva. And child dies at some point of time, that is tamas. Okay. We are fond of this word God. G-O-D. Generator, organizer, disposer. Creative energy is generator. Organizing, sustaining energy is organizer. Destructive energy is disposer. Same thing in Hindu mythology is named as Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. Brahma is the creator. Rajas. Vishnu is the sustainer, one who sustains the existence, and Mahesh, the Shiva energy, is the destroyer. Okay, so this is also the same thing. In science, whole of the physics depends on atom. Atom is split into three parts. Again, proton, the creative energy, neutron, the neutral energy, electron, the destructive energy. Okay, so you see from any angle in spiritual world, in materialistic world, in physical world and all, only these three activities are happening. Either we are creating something, or we are sustaining something, or we are destroying something. Nothing else is happening in this world. So this is why it is said that whole world is nothing but the interplay of gunas, or functioning making of gunas. Okay. Now the problem is that our human problem is that we have only accepted rajas, we have only accepted sattva, we have not accepted tamas. We have accepted creation, we have accepted sustenance, we have not accepted tamas, the destructive part. When a relationship starts, everyone loves it. When relationship sustains, people love it. And when relationship breaks up, people don't want it. But that is the rule of nature. Whatever starts will end one day. You cannot do anything about it. If a child has taken birth, he will die someday. You cannot do anything about it. The main problem with all of us is that we have only accepted two gunas. Rajas and Sattva, we have not accepted tamas. Even like simple activity like inhaling is rajas. The point between inhale and exhale, the moment, the second is sattva and exhaling is tamas. Okay, we have only accepted rajas and sattva. We are very much afraid of tamas. We are very much afraid of anyone like a going away from our life, anything destroying and all. But that is also part of the nature. Gunas are part of the existence. It is also functioning of the God, the destructive part. Okay. So the mind takes over the consciousness, but consciousness is always present. Okay, understand this thing. The main thing, that consciousness is always present. What? How to understand it? Like through an example. Best example is that if I go to sleep and I happen to see a dream, and then I get up in the morning and the thought comes that, okay, I had this dream. I saw this dream when I was asleep. Now, the main thing is that you were in sleep. Who saw that dream? There has to be something awakened inside you who observed that dream. Okay? Otherwise, you are sleeping. Who saw that dream? That means something is awakened inside you. Who had like experience of that dream, that awakened state is consciousness. That is always there. So when I told Emily to observe the mind, what happened? That consciousness got active. Okay, that consciousness which is in the background, it got active and it started observing the mind. What is happening in the mind? For one moment, that observant mode, the consciousness mode got active. Okay? in spiritual sense, we can say that in that particular moment, we all are conscious, but in that particular moment, Emily came into the mode of higher consciousness because she was in observant mode. If she can keep it as is throughout the day, 24/7, that observant mode, then she is super conscious or enlightened. Okay? Enlightenment is nothing more than this super conscious mode. Someone who is always conscious of his thoughts, his patterns in life, always aware. Okay, nothing else. There is nothing like some God will come and shake hands with you when you are enlightened. Nothing like that. It is just that you are awakened. You observe every thought, every pattern of your life. You are aware of every thought or every pattern of your life. So this is what to begin with. That consciousness takes birth and we are that consciousness, but it gets overlapped due to the conditioning of the society. In whichever society we take birth, mind overtakes it. Mind can function into these three gunas, and among these three gunas, we have only accepted rajas and sattva. We have not accepted tamas. That is the main problem. The day we will accept tamas also, destruction also, we will be free from all the pain and suffering. Okay. Now, let's go into theory of evolution, Charles Darwin. Okay. So, as per his theory of evolution, we are coming from various animal incarnations and all. And suppose someone has taken like very initial birth. Okay. Suppose I was in my previous incarnation, I was an animal. Due to some reason, I got this human life. So, I may get the human body, but my animalistic traits cannot go away just like that. I will be tamasic prominent for first few lives. First 4 or 5 lives, I will be more tamasic person. I will be more animalistic person. Okay, because I am coming from animal incarnation. I just got the human body. It doesn't mean that all the animalistic traits will go away. So, I will be more aggressive, I will be more violent, I will maybe like fond of non-veg food, that is also an indication of tamasic person. I may like those things which may create illusion, tamas, that is intoxication, drugs or alcohol. I will be interested in these kind of things, I may be violent also. So, just imagine a person has taken like first incarnation. And he gets involved into these activities. Then he takes the second incarnation. He continues with these activities. Then the third incarnation, third human life, he still continues, but some sort of awareness starts coming in that, okay, what I am doing? I am wasting my time. Why I am so violent? Why I am so like lethargic, lazy kind of person and all. And from fourth, fifth incarnation, now the energy starts moving from tamas to rajas. Now tamas is getting exhausted. And the person is moving towards the rajasic side of life. Okay. So we all have these gunas. We all have. Okay. But in different percentages. I may be like 40% tamasic, 20% rajasic, 40% sattvic. Emily may be like 50% sattvic, 25% rajasic, 25% tamasic. Ian sir may be like 70% sattvic, 15% rajasic, 15% tamasic. Okay, we all have these like gunas in different percentage. The aim is having this equilateral triangle, 33, 33, 33. That is the aim where we need to reach. Okay. 33.33% of tamas, 33.33% of rajas, 33.33% of sattva. Then it is balanced energy. And now make one more diagram here. The moment this energy is balanced, 33, 33, 33, you are gone. It means nirguna. You are beyond gunas, you are in life. That's it. Another way of saying is that 24 hours of the day, 8 hours of tamas, 8 hours of rajas, 8 hours of sattva should be there. Divide your 24 hours into this type of life, where 8 hours you are tamasic, 8 hours you are rasic, 8 hours you are sattvic. Tamasic is also necessary. Okay, understand. If there is no tamas element in the existence, we may not be able to end this call. If there is no tamas element in the existence, you will start from your home for your office and you will not be able to put brakes on your vehicle at the office. Tamas is stopping energy. Okay? If there is no tamas, then you may not be able to sleep properly. Okay? People who are lacking tamasic energy, they have serious problem of insomnia. Okay? So, tamas is also important. It is not like tamas should not be there. Okay? We need not to get into that mode that tamas should not be there. Tamas is important. It has its own importance. Sleep is also important. Having a proper sleep is also important. So, it has its own importance. Now, as I was saying that person has got initial incarnation, he got involved into tamasic activities, animalistic activities, and then after 4 or 5 lives, whenever the awareness starts happening, then the person will move into rasic and sattvic elements, sattvic activities. So the soul which takes birth as a criminal in one incarnation is the same soul which takes birth as Buddha in one incarnation. Because he goes through the journey till then. Now, some examples. Hi, Ria, how are you?
Hi, I'm doing well, thanks.
Great. So, understand it like this. Understand these gunas are fluid by nature. Fluid means you can take actions in your life to change these percentages. As I said, the aim is to reach the balancing point. And the circumstances, situations we go through in life are the ways by which we can balance the situation, balance the gunas. Okay. Universe provides the opportunity to us with every situation in life. Every situation is nothing but the opportunity. With that situation, you become better or bitter is your free will. Okay? And that is your wish whether you want to become a better person or a bitter person. Okay? That will decide whether you are moving from tamas to rajas or rajas to tamas. Okay? It is like that. So, first example is of a pure tamasic person. The most tamasic person I have seen in my life. He is one of my relatives, to be exact, my mother's brother. Okay, my mother's brother, my maternal. So, just see the life. He is in his 60s now. He never worked. He never did any job, any work. In my memory only, I remember him getting at least 100 to 150 jobs and he quit all of them, many of them on the same date. He went to join and he came back on the same date. Okay? He survived throughout his life on the resources of others. Just pay attention now what I'm saying. Who survives on the resources of others? Animals. Right? Animals survive. If you have a dog or cat in your home, that dog or cat is surviving on resources of your resources. Okay, that is the first indication that this person is like just a new incarnation in human body. Very abusive language. Okay, like lots of like now he's 60s and all, so now the energy is not that much, but when I was growing up, very abusive by language. Very aggressive person. Okay, very like shouting, yelling and all. Again, the tamasic qualities. Now few like traits which will give you an indication the level of tamas. If he is alone in home and sitting in a room, his room will be completely dark. No light, no electricity. He will sit in a dark room. So dark that if you are entering, you have to keep your mobile light on, that you can see what is there. Okay? Dark energy, tamas. If he is eating food, he will take one morsel in his mouth. Before he can swallow it, he will take two other morsels. Animals eat like this. Continuously. Okay? The funniest part, if I tell you that, suppose there is a plastic chair, and if I tell you that, okay, just like pick this chair and put it there in another room, what you will do? You will pick up the chair and you will put it in another room. If I tell this person, he will drag it. He will drag it till there. Why to put even that much of effort, that pick up and then put it there? I can also drag it. So a person who is not willing to put any action at all, someone who is just not willing to put any action, as I said, this guy must have got to like 100 to 150 jobs, and many of the jobs he left on the first day. Okay? So pure tamasic person, you will not get more tamasic, in my experience at least, I cannot see more tamasic person than this. Now, it shows that this person is coming from animal incarnation to human incarnation in first few lives. He will go through these lives. He will go through like tamasic lives for few times, and then the awareness will come that okay, I'm wasting my time. Why I'm wasting life? And it is nothing to condemn him. We all have lived such lives. Okay, we all have been tamasic. It is not that this is my first birth and I started talking about spirituality all of a sudden. I am coming from these incarnations. You are coming from these incarnations. But just to understand. Through example, I am taking this example. So this person will evolve through. Okay. Hi, Lily. How are you? Okay. We are in the middle of the session. You may have to like check half an hour recording so that you will find the connection. We are just talking about elements of the nature, rajas, sattva and tamas, or you can say creation, sustenance and destruction. Only these three activities are happening. That is what we are talking. The first example of this tamasic person of my relative, that who is not willing to take any action. And I was talking and I was telling that he got many opportunities in life. This is what I was saying. Even in this life, it is not that he didn't get any opportunity. He got like 100 to 150 jobs, but he refused to take challenge. So universe provided you opportunities that from tamasic, you can move to rajasic and sattvic, but he refused. In some life in future, he will take the opportunity. Okay. So the basic difference between from a tamasic and rajasic person, okay, forget about sattvic for now, okay? Because sattvic is something very high. Either we are tamasic or we are rajasic. A tamasic person, if you give him a situation, he will see all the obstacles in the situation. He will like enumerate you all the obstacles he is going to face in dealing with that situation. If a rajasic person is there, same situation, he will see all the opportunities and chances in that situation. That is the main difference between a tamasic person and rajasic person. The perception, the perspective is changing. One person is thinking at all the negative things, all the obstacles I have in my life. One person is thinking about all the challenges. How this situation can help me in growing. Okay, so that is what is seen from tamas and rajas. Now few examples. Okay, few examples of rajasic people. This was the example of a tamasic person. Now let's take few examples. Rajasic people. There is a lady named Muniba Masri. She is a lady from Pakistan. Her story goes like this, that when she was like in her teenage, like 18 years, 18, 19, she got married. Around mid-20s, she met with a like horrible accident in which she was left on the bed for her whole life. Okay. Spine broken and all, and she was told that, okay, you cannot even move from this bed. From that situation, she developed a business out of it. Okay. And nowadays, she is a motivational speaker, goes to different school, colleges, functions to motivate people. She is living on wheelchair. Okay. Her whole life is on wheelchair only. But she has the guts to fight it out. Even in that situation, now compare with this lady with my uncle. Okay, this guy got all the opportunities and he like sat back. He stepped back from all the opportunities. This lady has no opportunity. Her whole body is destroyed and this lady is ready to take the challenge. That is the main difference between tamasic and rajasic person. Tamasic person is always like looking at the excuses, how he can avoid the situation. And rajasic person is always looking at the challenges, how this situation can help me grow. Okay. Helen Keller, most of us will be aware of it. Helen Keller. People in India would know her from Black movie, okay? Black movie of Amitabh Bachchan and Rani Mukherjee. You cannot have worse start of your life than Helen Keller. Born deaf, dumb and blind, still graduated, okay? Even like in those times, even like perfectly healthy person was unable to graduate. Okay. And this lady, born deaf, dumb and blind, had the guts to like challenge herself and become a graduate. Okay. Perfectly rajasic person. Wants to achieve. Okay. She is not going down to her situations. Another example of similar is like Nick Vujicic. Born with only a torso and head. He has no hands, no legs. Okay. He is born with only this torso and the head. And he had the guts to become a motivational figure, going to all over the world to give motivational speeches to the people. He transformed his depression into motivation. When he was in like his early life, teenage and all, he was very depressed. What is the purpose of this life? Why I got this life where I cannot do anything? Okay. So from that situation, he like transformed his depression into motivating others. He goes to school, colleges, he gives sessions to the people, to the children specifically, that, okay, if I can come out of my situation, what is your excuse? Okay. So this is again a rasic person. He's not going down because of his problems, his challenges. He's utilizing those challenges to achieve something in life. Okay. Now, let's add astrology into it. Now where this session is going to help us. In astrology, we pay a lot of attention on exalted planets, planets in good dignity. Okay, this person has Radha madam, just okay, we can talk later. Okay, it is distracting me, sorry. So okay, in astrology we pay so much attention on exalted planets, okay, or good dignity planets. If planets are in good dignity, exalted, okay, person's life is great and all that. Astrologers announce the moment they see exalted planets, okay, great life ahead, okay, like especially with Sun exalted, Jupiter exalted, okay, it, and this person is going to have great life. There, Mark David Chapman comes as intriguing figure. Why? This guy is born with four exalted planets, not one or two, four exalted planets. Sun exalted, Jupiter exalted, Saturn exalted, Venus exalted. And all he ended up in doing is killing John Lennon. There cannot be any reason for killing someone, but the reason he has given is that I was a nobody, I could not accept myself as a nobody, I wanted to be somebody. And the easiest way to become a somebody is to kill the biggest somebody of that time. Okay? What it shows? It shows that planets may be strong, but the consciousness was very good. He's looking at easy options. He is not ready to work hard and persevere. John Lennon had a worse chart than him. Okay. This is the drawback of exalted planets or good dignity planets. What is the drawback? Is that person, these planets don't let you be happy or be satisfied with average success. They push you. Okay, what are you doing? Are you happy with this job? 9-to-5 job? This like a meager salary? Are you happy with this? You should be world famous now. By now. Okay? What you are doing? So this is the way exalted planets push you. Now, if someone is pushed like this and someone is lacking consciousness, lacking awareness, he will see the easiest way to become famous. He has become famous. There is a Wikipedia page. There are movies were made on Mark David Chapman. More movies on Mark David Chapman rather than John Lennon. Okay. So that is it. He has become famous, but for all the wrong reasons. What it shows is that planets are strong, chart is very strong, but the individual is weak. Just understand it. I have a chariot. I have four strong horses arranged in the chariot. I need a strong chariot driver also. Otherwise, these strong horses will take me for a ride. So this is why, like relying on the dignity of the planets is not like a foolproof way of predicting anything in astrology. Not necessary. If you have like exalted planets, your life will be great. Okay? There is the best example in this Tamas and Rajas I can give is that Michelangelo, the main sculpture for which he was famous, the Jesus and the Mary, Mother Mary, that rock was placed in front of a shop for years and no one was looking at that rock. Okay, and Michelangelo made that famous sculpture out of that rock, which was neglected. And in 1970s, a person came into a museum and he broke the rock for same purpose, for fame. He broke that sculpture for the same purpose, fame. What it shows, Michelangelo is a creative person. He could see sculpture from the rock also. And that person who destroyed the sculpture, he could see again the rock from the sculpture. He is tamasic. This person is rasic, Michelangelo. Another example of the same nature is Reverend Jim Jones. Again, sun exalted, Venus exalted. Two exalted planets. If you are faint-hearted, don't search for this guy much. Okay, you will come to know about an incident where it was a mass suicide. Okay, 900 people committed suicide at one time. And he was the ringleader. He orchestrated it. And in the most creepiest way, he left the recording of that motivational speech, if I say so, by which he motivated people to commit suicide. Okay? Sun exalted, Venus exalted is still this type of activity. So this is what I am saying, that we are trying to interpret everything, the houses, the signs, the planets, the nakshatra, but we don't know about the person who is going to utilize this. The individual, the soul, how strong is the soul? Whether that soul is at tamasic level, tamasic prominent, or rasic prominent, or sattvic prominent, we don't know. Okay? That is where the real difficulty is. I did an interesting calculation one day that how many children take birth in cities like Delhi or Bombay in one day. Okay. And I kept on dividing. I reached a figure of a very conservative figure of 80 children in 1 minute. This is very conservative figure. You can easily make it 125 children. Let's take average 100 children. 100 children in 1 minute. What does it mean that not only their D1 chart, but D60 chart will also be the same? Every chart will be identical. Can we say that these 100 children are going to behave in same way, in same situation? No. They will have different choices. What is making the difference in the choices is the level of their gunas. What level they are in, are they tamasic prominent or rasic prominent or sattvic prominent? That is the whole difference. Okay? And whatever prominence you have in your chart, or you have in your soul, I should say consciousness, at whatever level you are, you will be attracted towards that quality of your chart. What I am trying to say is this. Every planet represents something tamasic, something rasic, something sattvic. Okay? Mars represents violence. Mars represents real estate also. Mars represents protection also. Venus represents wealth and sex. Venus represents a relationship. Venus represents service and devotion. Okay? So, if we take example of Venus. Okay? Venus represents wealth and sex. Okay? That is tamasic representation of Venus. Venus represents relationship and creativity. That is rasic representation of Venus only. Venus represents service and devotion. That is sattvic level of Venus. Now, if I am tamasic prominent, I will be like I will be attracted towards the tamasic qualities of Venus automatically. If I am rajasic prominent, I will be attracted towards the rajasic qualities of Venus automatically. And if I am sattvic prominent, I will be attracted towards sattvic qualities of Venus, that is service and devotion, automatically. No matter how much someone counsels me, okay? If I am tamasic person, no matter how much you are counseling my uncle or how much you are counseling Mark David Chapman or how much you are counseling any of these people whom we discussed, like the Reverend Jim Jones and all, they will be attracted towards tamasic qualities because these are like initial few lives. Unless and until they exhaust it, they cannot move forward. Okay? So this is the whole thing, that whatever level you are, you will be attracted towards that. And how to know the level is only by communicating, interacting with someone, and only by looking at the choices they make in their life. Okay? You cannot know someone's this guna's level by their chart. Okay, by their astrological chart, you cannot know. Because again, like 100 children are taking birth in 1 minute. All are going to have the same chart. So how to know the kind of choices they are making? Okay, kind of like when you speak to someone, whether the person is talking more in destructive terms or talking more in creative terms. If a relationship, a conflict is happening, okay, if I'm in relationship, there is some disagreement with my partner, if I'm looking to resolve the conflict or I'm looking to, okay, let's find another person. I'm using it as an excuse to break up. Okay, that shows the difference whether I'm a tamasic person or I'm a rajasic person. Guna is more prominent in my life. So as I said, like these gunas are fluid, okay? We can change it as we go through the life, okay? Through all the circumstances, situations we go through with people, those are all opportunities in front of us to change those gunas level, okay? Now, few examples of those people who changed during one life, okay? It is not necessary that if I am born as tamasic prominent, I will die as tamasic prominent. Not necessary. Within one life, I can change, okay? First example is Ram Das. Born as Richard Alpert. Okay, so this guy was, he started as a psychology teacher and he was teaching in Harvard and all. At the same time, he was very much interested in psychedelics, drugs, LSD and all. He conducted some experiments with drugs on other people, including minor children. Okay, when the matter got exposed, he was fired from the Harvard, obviously. Now, if you see the very tamasic start of life, okay, someone who is into drugs, psychedelics, not only for himself, experimenting on minor children also. For that, he is getting fired. Now, through a friend, he comes to know about a spiritual guru in India, Neem Karoli Baba. He travels to India, he is transformed, he takes initiation, and he becomes Ram Das. Okay? Now, the same person goes back to the West as the most influential voice of Neem Karoli Baba, and towards the end of his life, he is accepted as a spiritual guru in the West. same person. Okay, we can say, oh, it is influence of Neem Karoli Baba. Neem Karoli Baba came in thousands of people's of life. They all didn't become Ramdas. It is the ability of the person also that he could transform himself. Okay, so the possibility of transformation is available in this life also. Circumstances, situations will come where you can grow, you can evolve. People will come into your life who will tell, okay, why don't you meditate? Why don't you join this yoga class? Why don't you do this or that? That is an opportunity, whether you say yes or no, that is your way. Okay. So Ramdas is like a huge example of some how one person can transform his whole life within one life. He can start as a like a drug addict and he can end as like this spiritual. Okay. Another example, now next two examples are like close to my heart for different reasons. People who know me from some time, they know that I'm very much interested in criminal psychology, especially the psychology of serial killers. Ed Kemper, okay, if you search about this guy, and all you will find is 7 feet tall, imposing personality. Okay, you need not to ask who is Ed Kemper. When you see the picture, you know that he is Ed Kemper, and no one else can be Ed Kemper. So this guy, he took birth somewhere in 1948. His father was in army, and after his birth, his parents took divorce, separated, and the child's custody was given to the mother. Okay. His only fault in his life was that he was exact look-alike of his father. Okay. His only fault that he was exact look-alike of his father. So his presence in front of his mother's eyes was a continuous reminder of her failed marriage. Okay. So whatever torture she wanted to do to the husband, she started doing to the child. Because he was exact look-alike. All those tortures are mentioned in Wikipedia page. Now, 20 years fast forward, this guy becomes a serial killer and he starts killing women who are looking like his mother. Okay? Understand. Purely psychological case. Like the mother, howsoever mother behaved, he started behaving the same. Mother tortured him because he was look-alike of father. He started torturing women who were looking like his mother. Okay. Then one day he was like just sitting there and reflecting, why did I kill the first woman? Oh, she was looking like me. Okay, fine. Second woman, she had the haircut like my mother. Third woman, she had nail polish like my mother. Fourth woman, she had lipstick like my mother. Okay, fine. I'm killing my mother. It is like that. Then he realized that actually I am killing my mother. That's when, like the unfortunately, last murder was of his mother. He committed a murder of his mother, and he surrendered. Up to this point, I am not in favor of this guy. Okay. Up to this point, I am not. But what happens after that is like. Gives me an indication, maybe 1% improvement is there. After getting into like prison, first of all, he asked for death penalty for himself. Okay, he said that I don't deserve to live, give me death penalty. As California state at that time had no death penalty clause, he was given life sentence, life imprisonment. He became eligible for parole multiple times. After that, he refused to take parole. He said that I am under all these restrictions inside the prison. I am behaving nicely. I don't know what will happen if I go out in the street again and if I happen to see another woman like my mother. I don't know how will I react. So it is better that I should stay here only. So maybe 1% this person, maybe like 0.5% this person improved, which may be helpful in his future lives, incoming lives. Okay. Likewise, there is this person, Jeff Dahmer. Netflix recently published one docu-series on him, Dahmer. Okay. Again, a serial killer killed around 20-21 kids, boys. Okay. And after surrendering, after a few years of his imprisonment, he asked for baptism. Okay, he had that I should be baptized by a priest and all. He asked for that. He got baptized. After, now anyone can be baptized, not a big deal, right? But following the teachings of Bible is more important. Implementing them in your real life, that is more important than baptism. One day he was attacked by a fellow prisoner inside the prison, and he followed the teaching of Bible, show the other cheek. He didn't respond back. The other prisoner kept on hitting him, and Jeffrey Dahmer got killed, but he didn't defend himself. Okay. This also shows maybe 1% some improvement is there. Okay. Which is going to make a huge change in his next life. So all the circumstances in life are providing us the opportunity. I am not defending them. Please don't misunderstand that, okay, I'm defending them by any means. I'm not defending what Ed Kemper did or what Ram Dass did as Richard Alpert, or what Jeffrey Dahmer did. I'm only saying that opportunity is always there of growing, of evolving with every circumstances, with every situation in life. As I said, either you can become bitter or better. It's your choice. That is your free will. This is where I will say free will exists. Okay? We will discuss free will concept a little later. So, as I said, like the main thing is that all the houses, all the like planets, all the signs of your chart are indicating thousands of the things. As we know, like we all are in astrology from like very long time. We all know one planet represents 1,000 truckload of things. Then one house represents truckload of things. These things can also be divided into three categories. Some of these things are creative by nature, rajasic. Some of these things are like sustaining by nature, that is sattvic. And some of these things are destructive by nature, that is tamasic. As I said, Venus represents wealth and sex. Venus represents relationship and creativity. Venus represents service and devotion. Venus is giving you all the option what you want to take. It's your choice. I cannot say that I was going through Mars Dasha, that's why I hit that person. Mars Dasha doesn't give me guarantee to hit someone. Okay? Many years back, I posted something on my Facebook page about 12th house. 12th house represents this, and I said 12th house also represents intoxication, alcohol and drugs and all that. So one person commented, oh, that means I'm going through 12th house dasha, that's why I'm drinking. Well, 12th house represents meditation also, why you are not meditating? Okay. 12th house is giving all the opportunities for you. Why you are specifically interested in one activity, not in other activity, that is your choice. Best example in this matter is Osho. Okay. Osho has like about 1,000 plus books on his name as author. Why people are interested in only one book, Sex to Superconsciousness? That is people's choice. That is not Osho's choice. That speaks about people, where they are. Otherwise, in Osho's shop, you will get the books on Meera also, books on Buddha also, books on meditation, yoga, Patanjali Yoga Sutra, what not. He has preachings on every incarnation, every like enlightened master. Why you are so much concerned about that one book, Sex to Superconsciousness? An interesting calculation was done after Osho passing away, that how many times in 30 years of his preaching career, he used the word sex. The count came 15,000. And how many times he used the word meditation, count came 1,500,000. So he should be sex guru or he should be meditation guru. This shows our choice. What we want to take from the Osho shop. All books are available. Okay? This and our choice shows our level, where we are in gunas, tamas, rajas, or sattva. Okay? So this is the main thing. Even like every activity can be rasik, tamasik, or sattvic. If I just bring the example of the most condemned activity of all the times in all the cultures, that is sex. Okay, it can be at three levels also. Sex can be tamasic also, sex can be rasic also, sex can be sattvic also. How? Tamasic is means body level. It is like a person visiting a brothel or a prostitute for his physical needs. Okay, that is why he is going there. So prostitute is also getting into sexual intercourse for money because she needs it and this guy needs it for his physical needs. So that is tamasic use of sex. Sattvic is when two people are in love, sorry, rasic is when two people are in love with each other. Okay. In the first example, there is no emotion involved, only like physical labor. Rasic is when two people are in love with each other. They have all the emotions with each other. They get into sex. It is rasic sex. What is sattvic? Sattvic is if you have any idea about Vigyan Bhairav Tantra. Where does it start? Shiva, Parvati is sitting in the lap of Shiva and they are discussing some sexual postures which can be utilized for meditation. Okay, so that is sattvic level, tantra. Tantra is sattvic sex. So anything can be at three level. Any activity, any like trait can be at three level, tamasic, rasic, sattvic, where you are focusing. That is your choice. Okay, we cannot say that okay, I was going through this Mars, the shower, Mars was in Cancer, that's why I end up in beating my wife. Okay, not necessary. Mars also represents protection. You could have protected your wife. Okay, so this is what finally, like astrologer's job is to give you the best possibility of Sattva. Best possible. Okay. If you come to me for consultation or I come to you for consultation and I show you my chart, your job is to tell me the best possibility available, sattvic. Because that is my potential in this life. Whether I go for it or not is still my free will. At least I cannot say later, no one guided me properly. Otherwise, I would have done that. Okay, to close this door of excuse, it is necessary that I should be told the best possibility of it. Okay, regardless of whether I'm listening to that or not. So astrologers should give the best possibility. Okay, can change any moment, they can change any moment, breakthrough can happen. So like it can happen that I may counsel someone and he may be at that point, that breakthrough point where the tamasic is ending and rajasic is beginning. Okay, so maybe the transformation is there to happen. Okay, in that particular moment. So this is why it is necessary that you do your job properly, regardless of whether anyone is listening or not. This is also why perfect predictions are not possible, because we don't know when these gunas are going to change. When the person is going to make the final choice in his life. Right, balancing. Okay, I think I covered. Last thing is like, there is a movie named Yes Man. That is like a very good example of these gunas. Okay, Yes Man is a story like a Jim Carrey movie. It is a story of a guy who is all about saying no in his life. Okay, a movie starts with Jim Carrey only saying no to everything. If his friends are making plan, they want to meet, they want to go for a movie, they are like organizing a party, this guy is always making excuses not to come, saying no, no, no. And then he meets a guru, and guru takes one promise that from now onwards, for 1 year, you will say yes in any given situation. For 1 year, just say yes. So no is tamas. This guy was so much into tamasic energy, tamasic prominent, that first yes was necessary to balance the energy. Okay. Most of us are in tamasic level, okay, tamasic prominent, and that we can see from our choices on, okay. So suppose someone has like 80% tamasic, so first of all, some percentage should move to rajasic. First of all, he should start saying something yes, something creative. From tamas, we are supposed to go towards rajas first, okay. And then the triangle takes place, as I said, Satguru is the balancing point where all the gunas are 33, 33, 33. That is like balancing point. That is what is supposed to happen. That is what is like the goal of this life or any life. Okay. Right. Any question? After my monologue.
Hi, Swamiji. So
yeah.
I was thinking about this balancing point thing because, you know, I'm a Libra ascendant. Sattva, the balance point of Sattva, this balance point of Rajas, the balance point of Tamas, does it have to be 33% equal, or doesn't it depend on Sattva itself? Bringing out the best qualities of Sattva. That's the balance point. Bringing out the best, you know, like that.
No, it has to be equal. Like that is the end goal. Okay.
But why does it have to be equal?
If they are not equal, you are prominent by one or the other gunas. You are impacted by one or the other guna. When they are equal, then you are beyond gunas, nirguna state. Understand it like this, that prison is prison, handcuffs are handcuffs, whether they are of iron or gold. Okay. Tamasic lifestyle is also prison, sattvic lifestyle is also prison. Spirituality also brings arrogance. I meditate for 8 hours. How much you meditate? Okay. This person is my guru. My guru is better than your guru. Okay, this is also arrogance. So spirituality also brings arrogance. Sattvic element also brings arrogance. Just that it is better arrogance in comparison to tamasic. I'll give you an example, a very creepy example. So, this guy, Ted Bundy, he was like captured at that time, okay, serial killer. And another serial killer was going on his rampage, he killing people and all. And police was not able to find, okay, that who is this new serial killer. People, like police asked help from the people and clues and all. One letter came from Ted Bundy that I can help you. I can help you in finding this guy. Any idea why Ted Bundy was so generous? And actually what the points he gave came out to be true. The clues he gave. Any idea why such generosity from Ted Bundy?
Because he knows that path, no. He walked that path already.
This guy was about to take over the count of Ted Bundy. Okay. If he continues killing people, he will overpower and people will not remember me as best serial killer. People will remember him as best serial killer. So even being a serial killer can be like best or worst. Okay, so arrogance can be coming from anywhere, from tamasic activities also, sattvic activities also. Fetters are fetters, handcuffs are handcuffs, whether they are of iron or gold, doesn't make any difference. Okay, so that's why the balancing point is necessary. Whether you put Osho in Rolls Royces, then also he is happy, he is smiling. Whether you put him into police van, then also he is happy, he is smiling. And you deport him also, then also he is happy, he is smiling and waving you off.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this is what is important. This 33, 33, 33, 8 hours, 8 hours, 8 hours means you are not connected with any of the gunas. You are not attached with any of the gunas. You are free as a consciousness. You are utilizing all the gunas. Okay? You are utilizing, but you are not attached with them.
Mm. No, so... You know, the definition of tamas, for instance, is inertia, inactivity, dullness, lethargy, darkness. The definition of sattva is truth, purity, positivity, balance, peacefulness, virtuousness. I don't know, you know, if something is totally good, wouldn't it be better to drift towards sattva, to more sattvic behavior, than to have tamas also in your life? I know that tamas is there in every step of evolution, because in order to grow, the old has to be destroyed, the new has to be created,
right.
That is creative energy, and the maintenance is the sattva part.
Right.
So every step of evolution, you have to have all three gunas.
Yeah.
But for sattva to dominate,
no.
I'm trying to understand how all three have to be equal. I don't understand that concept.
Okay,
I'm sorry.
sorry to interrupt you, but do you have anything to complete? Then I will start.
No, that's all. That was the main question.
Okay, this is what you need proper sleep also. You need proper work also. You need proper leisure time also. Okay, proper the time of worship and prayers and all meditation. Everything is equally needed in life. Okay? A person who cannot sleep properly for 8 hours cannot work efficiently for the next 8 hours. Just understand this simple thing. So tamas is very much required. Okay? In its 33%, it is very much necessary. Just understand, you have only accelerator nor no brake in your vehicle. What will happen? Right? So you need both of them together. Okay? Too much of good can also become harmful. Too much of sweet also causes diabetes. Okay? I think Bernard Shaw said or someone is that I am very much afraid of the concept of heaven of the Hindus, because they say that in heaven only good things are there. It will be such a boring place, right? Only good things are happening, and like it is never ending. You need everything in life. It is not that we go for only romantic movies. We go for like tragedies also. We go for horror movies also, crime movies also. We need everything in our life.
Thank you, Swamiji.
Right. Roshni, you wanted to ask something?
Yes, sir. I was thinking about these food choices that we make. Like, for example, I love to eat non-veg. So should we like do it like 33% like veg, non-veg and everything?
Okay. Till the point you feel connected with non-veg food. Understand, it is all about exhausting the energy. Okay. Don't repress it, first of all. Okay. If you feel like having non-veg food, still have it. Have it consciously. Have it consciously. Consciously means that in a way you are making your stomach a graveyard. Okay. And then have it. Okay. So this is the thing that that consciousness awareness will help you in coming over that tamasic quality, tamasic trait, and you will move into rasic in this matter. Okay. So understand one thing, like Osho says that your food is not your food, you become your what you eat. Okay. Just understand, I'm not condemning your food choice. I'm not condemning anyone's food choice. I'm just saying the fact. Okay. If non-veg food is getting prepared, means you are killing an animal. That animal cannot be in a very pleasant state at the time of that killing. Okay. Now you eat that animal's meat. Now that negativity is coming into your body. People go into this logic that, okay, plants also have life. We are killing plants also. This is where the whole thing is about evolution again. Understand? Plants are at the base of evolution, then animals, and then human beings. Okay? So what does it mean that as a human being, if I have a choice between plant and animal, then I should eat plant, because an animal is at higher evolution level than the plant. Okay. But if I am stuck at some place where I have no vegetable food available, and only non-veg food is available, then I can have non-veg food because my life is more important than animal life. I am at a higher evolution level. Okay? If I am stuck, just pay attention. It is not that I am intentionally going to a non-veg restaurant and saying, oh, there is no veg food available. Okay? It is not like that. If I am stuck at one place, where only non-veg food is available, veg food is not available, my life is more important than animal's life. I am at a higher evolution level, being a human being. Human life is more important than animal life. In that situation, I can eat an animal to sustain myself, to make myself live for a few more days. Okay? But when I have a choice that non-veg food is also available, veg food is also available, I should go towards veg.
Mm.
Okay. But if you have the desire, don't repress it again.
Yeah.
Don't repress it due to this session or whatever I'm saying. Exhaust that energy. Exhaust that tamasic energy and move towards rajasic energy. Okay. Radha madam, you wanted to ask something? You raised your hand.
Good morning, Swamiji. Just wanted to thank you for your knowledge. As usual, it's always expansion to consciousness, and I truly enjoyed it. I just have a little comment, which is a good comment. It helps me. It's, in the end, it is how your talk helps others. And of course you, because I think, I'm sure the teacher learns the most out of it. So this guna thing is so interesting. And I was thinking of, you know, how you write how Osho-ji's work is now very, you know, people talk more about it, but when he was alive, people didn't, it saw it in a different light. Yeah, I did not know who Osho was until my husband brought his to me to his attention. You know, he likes to read. So I just, that's how I got to know him. And through you, of course. And I know all my life Maharshi. So, but I'm putting them together. They're all spiritual masters. It's so beautiful. But the guna part is that Maharshi did also so much work on writing spiritual information, and especially if you read the Gita and Krishna's words, he says in chapter 2, verse 45, Nishchay Gunyo Bhavatu, right? That's the advice he gives to Arjuna. And he doesn't mean you have to force it. It's we humans have always this human desires. You know, in first chapter, Arjuna talks only about his problems, maybe 16 or so fundamental, essential problem he lays at the feet of Krishna, just a way of saying it. And Krishna just says one thing in 45, just be without that. Of course, though the world exists with it, but when you want a solution, you have to be without it. How do you do that? You contact the self, you know, when you go to meditation. Everybody has their own meditation, but I'm of course talking about transcendental meditation. It's a huge study, which I and my husband and myself is a good, great expert in it. Not great, but you know, kind of an expert. So, but the point is you come to the self, and then, it is related to our desires, what we want to do, like eating non-veg or whatever. So, and this is what I like, since I studied Jyotish with you, you made this so beautifully connection. I'm just explaining something so that I come to a conclusion, because I wanted to explain this properly. So you mentioned that you have to exhaust the karmic, you know, whatever it's in a Jyotish. So nice. Otherwise, before that class, I always used to judge people. But the moment I became your student, I realized after the study of Jyotish, we can't judge anybody. Everybody comes through a journey, life after life, and they do what they have to do. But that doesn't take away the wisest Vedic teachers have given yoga, which is coming back to the self. Right, that expands the consciousness, which we are in essence, and then all those traits, the little impurities falls off. That's been said. You mentioned also that tamas is needed, rajas is needed, sattva is needed, which is all beautiful and good, because it's connected to the world we live in. Because if we wanna execute our life, then that little bit ignorance, which is often called in Vedic terms in Sanskrit, lesha vidya, is needed to perform, to move, because otherwise we would die in depression. So my comment is I just love this work of yours. Thank you so much. It's really gave me more insights to move forward in my researches and all that. So I just wanted to thank you. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you. Anyone wants to ask anything or any comments? Sirisha, Patajit, yeah, Radha, okay, Emily, Lily.
Ça?
Yeah.
Yeah, just want to thank you, really.
Oh,
It's just
great.
yeah.
This is like also like we discuss two more things and then we can close for the session, close for the day. This is also how any event happens in this existence. This is also how like law of attraction works. Okay. That we have these three gunas, okay? Tamas, Rajas and Sattva, okay, creative energy, destructive energy, and sattvic energy, the sustaining energy. Now, whatever thought comes into your mind is also of either of these gunas. Either it is like tamasic thought of destroying something, or rajasic thought of creating something, or like sattvic thought of sustaining something. Now, what throughout the day we have thousands of the thoughts, but we don't pay attention to all the thoughts. We start paying attention or energy to the thought where we feel inclined towards, we feel attracted towards as per our gunas level. Okay, if I'm more tamasic person, I will be attracted towards destructive thoughts. I will be not be attracted towards creative or like this sustaining thought. Most important time is the initial time when the thought is coming into your mind and when we start giving attention to it. Okay, that is the most important time, because if you can change something, you can change in that moment. The moment we start thinking over it over time and all, there comes a time when energy overpowers us. Okay, then things have gone beyond the hands. Okay, two examples. George Floyd case, from where the BLM movement started, Black Lives Matter. If you pay attention to this incident, this is like an interesting incident. Even if you except for argument's sake that this guy George Floyd was the biggest criminal of the world, for argument's sake, although there was nothing on record, but for argument's sake, for one minute, if we accept that he was the biggest criminal of the world, even then his gun was taken away, he was handcuffed, he was made to lay down on the street face down. There was no way he can harm himself or he can harm anyone else. What was the need to put your whole body weight on his neck? You arrested him. The order was to arrest him. You arrested him. What was the need for that act? To put your whole body weight on someone's neck. But this is what happens. Initially, we give energy to a thought, and after some time, energy overpowers us, energy overtakes us, then things are not in our control. Then we end up in doing something which we never thought in the beginning. Okay? So this is these gunas and the energy and attention we give to them also decide what activities are happening. This police officer had given so much energy to this thought that I need to dominate this black guy, not realizing that he is already dominated. He is already on the floor. What else you know want to do? Okay? He is not even realizing it. Another incident, if you search for this guy, Chris Watts. Just you will get one Wikipedia page named Watts Family Murders. Okay. This case is from North Carolina, US. So this guy was living a happy life with his family, his wife, two daughters. His wife was pregnant with another child. And they happened to travel to in-laws place, like Chris Watts in-laws, okay? In-laws place for 1 month, like wife and daughters. In that 1 month time, this guy met another girl at office. And he started a relationship without telling the girl that he is already married and has a family. For next 1 month or 40 days, he started thinking that how can I start a new life with this girl? Okay. He started thinking means giving energy to this thought. Continuous energy for 30, 40 days. This existence works on the principle of demand and supply. You ask a question, you get the response. Okay. He asked the question, how can I live a new life with this girl? The response came in his mind, get rid of my wife. He ended up killing his wife when they returned. And two daughters also. He killed those two daughters also. Later during interrogation, he was asked like, how did you do this? So he said, I have no idea how did I do this. How I suddenly can kill someone who is part of my family. I've lived for my life for this family. And how can I all of a sudden kill? This is where the thing is important. Nothing happened all of a sudden. You gave energy for 40 days, 50 days. You gave the intention for 50 days to a destructive thought that how can I get rid of my wife? Mind gave you the ideas that, okay, these are the ways to get rid of your wife. So the main thing is that when you initially start giving energy to a thought, if you can change, you can change in that moment only. Once you start giving intense energy, a moment comes when energy takes you over. There is a point till the time we can push on accelerator and we can control the vehicle. But there comes a time when if you keep on pushing the accelerator, vehicle goes out of your control. Then you cannot do anything. And then you will say, oh, it is fated. You are not realizing that you started giving energy first place. Okay? Any event happens due to this only. Gunas only. This whole concept of law of attraction or manifestation is gunas only. You start thinking about something, some destructive force or creative force or sustaining force, you start giving energy, that energy makes you take actions. Like, take this example, I started this profession in 2015. I started with a site, with a Facebook page actually. Even site was not in my plan. Okay, Facebook page. Some friend gave me the idea that, okay, you can start a site. Okay, then I started a site. Now 10 years passed, means I have given energy of 10 years to this Rajasic activity. Now, if I suddenly, one fine day, I think that, okay, I'm stopping my work. I don't want to be an astrologer anymore. Even if I decide I cannot do anything about it, people will continue to contact me for at least 1 year. I cannot stop energy all of a sudden. Okay, so this is the also the like the any event can happen. Any event happens through the your energy or attention to the gunas, and it is your choice in that. Finally, like Ria wanted to discuss, I don't know if she is here, about fate versus free will, the age-old discussion. Understand it like this. Rather than like thinking about fate or free will, just understand where you stand. Okay? As I said, there is this consciousness and there is this human mind which is functioning through gunas. If you are living in human mind, okay, if you are living in human mind, and majority of us are living in human mind, how to know it? We all have criteria in mind. Okay? We all have this idea that this thing should happen, this thing should not happen. This is good, this is bad. This is right, this is wrong. Okay? As long as you have these criteria in life, you are living in mind. That means you are a person of free will. A person who is about fate and destiny has no criteria in life. Okay? He is in fate. Whatever happens, he is happy with it. Okay? Just an example, just a small story to give you an idea of a person who really believes in destiny. Okay? What type of person that can be? There is a Sufi story of a mystic, Bayazid. The story goes that he used to like travel to different houses, asking for food throughout the day, charity and all. And in the evening, he will sit with his disciples at one place. Whatever food they will get, they will first thank the God for the food, and they will eat and they will sleep. This is their whole day and daily activity. Once it happened that for 3 days they didn't get anything. For 3 days, no food, nothing. And still, Bayazid is coming in the night, in the evening, at that place. He is still sitting in prayers. He is thanking the God and he is going to sleep. On the third day, his disciples got pissed off. Okay, why you are thanking God now? For 3 days, we are sleeping hungry. We are starving for 3 days. Why you are thanking the God? He said that I am thanking God for giving me opportunity to observe fast. Okay? This is the person of destiny. This is the person of fate. For him, even remaining hungry is God's wish. God wanted to keep me hungry. I am hungry. What is the problem? He is giving me opportunity to observe fast. If you are at this level, if you are at this level of surrender and receptivity, then you are a person of fate, destiny. Otherwise, we all are people of free will, because we all have criteria. This thing should happen, this thing should not happen. This is good, this is bad. This is right, this is wrong. The main problem in the spiritual world which is happening is that people are at free will level, but they are talking of destiny. People are at Arjun level, but they are talking about Krishna. What Krishna said? Krishna said soul is immortal. Oh, if you know that soul is immortal, then what was the problem with COVID-19? If you really know that soul is immortal, why people were running around? Okay? Things like COVID-19 are the test of the spirituality of the people. How much we know that soul is immortal. Okay? So it is always better to wherever you are. Okay? Function at that level. If you are a person who has criteria in life, this is right, this is wrong. Because an enlightened person has no criteria in life, just like existence has no criteria in life. Existence has no criteria, no good, bad. Even as we are discussing right now, many people would be preparing to go for temple, mosque and churches for prayers. And many people would be planning for their next crime. Existence is open for everyone. You want to do this as you wish, you want to do that as you wish. Existence is not stopping anyone. Okay? If I say that I want to commit the crime, existence tells me as you wish. And if Lily says I want to stop Vishal from committing crime, existence says as you wish. Now, whomsoever uses energy more intensely will win. That's it. Existence only says as you wish. For everyone. Your wish. Whatever you want to. The moment you say, I am tired of all this nonsense, okay, as you wish. Enlightenment. Okay. Liberation. Okay. So the best way to understand the fate versus free will is that suppose there is a person who is standing on a ground floor. Okay. Suppose a person who is standing on a ground floor and there is another person who is standing on the top floor of the roof of the 10th floor. Okay, top floor. Well, this person who is standing on ground floor, he sees nearby and he doesn't see any like bus or conveyance coming his side. When the person on the top floor sees, he sees that there is a bus which is coming 2 kilometers down the road. For this person on ground floor, this bus is a future event. For the person who is on top floor, this bus is a present event. Okay? This person on the top floor can say that this bus is part of destiny. This person cannot say. This person on ground floor cannot say. Understand ground floor and top floor as like consciousness level. At our consciousness level, we cannot talk about destiny. We don't know what is in destiny. Everything is destined, but we don't know what it is which is destined. We are ignorant about it. Person like Krishna can say, or Jesus can say, that everything is destiny. They are standing on the roof of the top floor. They can see the bus coming. And they can see the bus going. Okay? They can say that it is all destiny, but we cannot say that it is all destiny. So rather than thinking whether it is fate versus free will, just think where you stand. Are you standing on the ground floor or the top floor? Most of us are in the ground floor. Okay? That's why Krishna can say so easily that kill Arjun, they are supposed to die, they are already dead. Because he can see that after 2 days, yeah, they will be dead. But Arjun cannot say that. Okay? Arjun cannot say that. So it is better that wherever we are, we should be functioning at that level. We should not be like at Arjun's level, at Arjun's consciousness, we should not be talking about soul is immortal. Okay? We should not be talking in the language of Krishna. Then. Any question from anyone?
Could you repeat the last thing that you said about the soul being immortal?
Sorry? Yeah, Lily, you were saying something?
Could you repeat the last thing you said about the soul being immortal? I didn't quite catch it.
So, like, Bhagavad Gita discussion goes... it is like if I just give you a very brief introduction of Bhagavad Gita, it is like a discourse between Arjun and Krishna happening in the middle of the battlefield. A war is about to start between two sets of cousins. Okay, it is like one family fighting. The metaphor is that no matter whom you fight, you are fighting within the one human family. Okay. It is not Russia and Ukraine fighting, it is one human family is fighting, okay? So the metaphor is that. And that war zone, this discourse happens between Arjun and Krishna. And Krishna, like Arjun feels perplexed that he's about to kill his own relatives and all, and he asks some questions about it. What is the purpose of this war where I have to kill my own relatives and all? And then Krishna narrates many different ways to understand this concept. And one of the way was that, okay, that they are anyway supposed to die one day or the other. You are anyway supposed to die one day or the other. So the physical body is supposed to die. The soul or consciousness will remain aware, will remain alive. So there he comes with this logic that soul is immortal and physical bodies anyways dying. So he gives this logic in order to convince Arjun to, it is one of the logic, it is not the whole of Gita, don't misunderstand it. Okay? So it is one of the logic which he gives to convince Arjun that it is necessary to fight the war. The reality is this, that actually where the Arjun was wrong, okay, throughout Bhagavad Gita, throughout 900 verses, 700 verses of Bhagavad Gita, he never said that war itself is wrong. Not a single time he said. He never said that no one should kill anyone. He only said that how to kill my own people, or what is the benefit of killing my own people? What does it mean, dude, that you are still ready to kill other people? Okay. All his questions were very precise, that my people should not be killed. Okay. It was completely selfish thought that, okay, my people should remain, let everyone else get killed. I don't care. Okay. So this is where Krishna had to intervene, that, okay, this guy is not becoming non-violent. This guy is becoming super violent because he is ready to kill others. He is not ready to kill his own people. Okay. He is not against the war itself. He is not against the killing itself. He is ready to kill other people. No issues. Okay. Not a single time he said that no one should kill anyone. No war should happen. Not a single time this sentence came. Whenever he spoke about, my family should not be killed. Okay. So this is where Krishna had to intervene many ways by which he tried to convince Arjun that war is necessary to be fought by him. So one of the ways was soul is immortal. Now, George Gurdjieff makes one addition in this, Russian mystic George Gurdjieff, he makes one addition in editing in Bhagavad Gita, that soul is immortal only for that person who has reached up to soul, who has realized his soul. Only for that person, soul is immortal. For people like us, we are in the body only. We don't know anything about soul. So body is mortal. Okay. So this is what I'm saying. These discussions are always at two levels. At consciousness level and mind level. We are at mind level. Okay. We have criteria also. Nothing else. And does it help?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, thank you for joining the session. I hope it was helpful. So this is the whole thing about the gunas of nature or life, that wherever we give the energy, those things start manifesting. And most of the time, most of the people are giving energy to the tamasic elements. Okay. Try to make more creative choices in life, more constructive choices in life. Try to make energy move towards rajasic and then sattvic. That will be much better. So at least we won't have the excuse that because of this Mars transit in Cancer, I started shouting and yelling at person. Okay. That Mars represents many other things. You could have done many other activities. Sirisha, you wanted to ask something or add something?
No, sir. I just wanted to say thank you. It was such a wonderful session. We did review some of these in the past, but again, refreshing this class is really very helpful. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Okay, thank you. Take care. All the best. Good night.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.